Feel free. Also, I'm blown away, guys. I am really blown away. We did not expect this. So this shows me that camp is going to happen in Powell this year. And so while we're here, let's take this time to understand the reason why we're doing what we're doing and the hope that we have. Because without the hope, why would we even have a camp that was focused on Christ? Just have a camp that is all the lessons and wisdoms and plays, and so we can just have a good time. That's not what this place is about. And you guys know that and support that. So I'm just going to welcome you here, and you can all stand for a prayer. And then remain standing until after the next song. Let's go forward. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are not worthy of being here. We're not worthy of the price that you paid on that cross. Not just the cross, but everything. From the very moment you entered the Garden of Gethsemane, you knew that your Father was going to leave you alone. That was the hardest thing to take. Lord, but all the scourging and the rods and the crown of thorns and the nails, the fact that your Father was going to leave you. Lord, we just want to remember and think back about why we're here and the price that it cost. It was so
that we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if it, in fact, the dead did not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If
we do have this really cool box that will be just over here. There's an awesome little pink sign that will be in front of it. And this, if you feel so inclined, is for our collection this evening. Half of what we collect will go to the Good News Club to give and introduce the gospel to children. A lot of the times when I work with the Good News Club, that happens for the first time. And it will also, the other half will go to the Westport Ministerial Association to help keep doing things like this. And at this time, I'm just so thrilled that even as we were starting, we were still putting up chairs back. That is great. God's people have not been put down at all. And I am thrilled with that. And as we come tonight to celebrate the grace that Christ gave us by going and enduring that, God's people are still strong. Will you pray with me? Father God, as we come here tonight to celebrate your death and burial, and we come in on Sunday to continue celebrating through your resurrection, we thank you so much for all that you've given us, for the grace, for the mercy, for the new covenant in your blood. And tonight, Lord, we pray that all that is collected will become seeds to be planted and to be harvested. And tonight we pray to the Lord of the harvest that he sends out workers to go and to harvest that which is planted. We pray that though all growth comes from you, that you give it abundantly. We pray all this in your Son's holy name.
Thank you. chose not to. He chose to suffer that night, that day, upon the cross. And it's down at the cross where our Savior died. Sing it out.
The gospel is not all of the New Testament. in verse 3, he begins to list what that gospel message is. Christ died for our sins. Christ died for our sins. Verse 4, he was buried and rose again 3 days later. And all of that was done according to the scriptures. That is the gospel. You may say, well, Dennis, what about the virgin birth? The virgin birth is foundational to our faith. It is absolutely an essential doctrine. But without the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, his birth would be just one more birth of a Jewish child in a very small, insignificant town in Israel 2,000 plus years ago. It's the death, the burial, and the resurrection that gives us victory, that gives us the hope that each of us have in this life and in the life to come. Without, the Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Christ had to die on the cross. There was no other way. On the road to Emmaus, when he encountered two of his disciples, they were mourning, they were grieving over his death, and Jesus says to them, "O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?" Christ knew that he would die. And he also knew that 3 days later he would be raised from the dead. You remember when he was in the temple talking to the religious leaders, and he said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it back up again." And they thought to themselves, "This man's crazy. He thinks he's going to rebuild this temple in 3 days." What they didn't understand was he wasn't talking about that physical structure in which they were seated. He was talking about his body. He said, "Destroy this body, and in 3 days it will rise again." Just as the scriptures, just as the prophets had said that it would. One Bible scholar has said that in the Christian theology of history, the death of Christ is the central point of history. Here all the road of the past converge, hence all the road of the future diverge. What we celebrate this week, what we celebrate Sunday, what we should celebrate every single day of our lives, the resurrection of Christ, is the very center point of our faith. It's the very center point of the history of all mankind. It is upon that death and that resurrection that everything revolves, and by which everything will be judged. One of the problems that people have sometimes when they're reading through the Bible is they get to those passages in the Old Testament that's kind of rough. There's a lot of sacrifices. There's a lot of things going on that makes people feel kind of squeamish. All of those Old Testament sacrifices pointed to the one that Christ would make there on the cross. They were a symbol. They simply pointed to what would one day be the real thing. You see, in the Old Testament, the sacrifices that the people brought, the sheep, the goats, the doves, whatever it was they brought to the priest, could only cover the sins of the people. It couldn't wash them away. And so every year they would come back. Every year they would come back because their sins were no longer covered by that blood. And I've read that there in the temple there was a trench that ran outside the city walls that was filled with blood 24 hours a day. 24 hours a day, there were priests in that temple sacrificing the animals that the people were bringing that their sins might be covered. And if you ever read about the furniture in the Old Testament, you know something you won't find? A chair. Because the priests never had time to sit down. They were so busy sacrifice an animal, one right after another, that the sins of the people might be covered. In Hebrews chapter 10, it says, "Every priest stands ministering daily and offering the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God."
praying for you. Every single day he is praying to his Father God for you and for me. Don't you find that incredible? Don't you find that awesome? Doesn't that fill you with a hope that no matter how bad things might get, Jesus is seated at his Father's side praying for you and your situation? And you know the Father is listening. You know the Father is listening. All that blood. Now, I know some people don't like to hear about the blood of Jesus. We had when I was pastoring several years ago, we had an older couple who would come up from Louisville about once a quarter to visit our little country church. Her parents were the first couple to be married when that structure was built a long time before. And so they would come up about once a quarter, and he was a retired pastor from another denomination, and very friendly, very nice, very loving people. But one Sunday I noticed that as he was going out, he wasn't all that friendly. And I wondered what was wrong, and his wife explained that she followed him out the door. She said he doesn't like sermons about the blood. You see, in too many of our churches today, we've taken away the blood of Christ. We've removed the songs from the hymn book. We don't sing about it. We don't preach about it. But Romans chapter 5 says we are justified and saved through his blood. Ephesians 1:7 says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. In Colossians 1, Christ has reconciled all things to himself and made peace through the blood of the cross. It's the blood that redeems us. As I shared recently with Westport Baptist, I believe that as Christ hung on that cross, every drop of blood in his body was poured out on that ground there at Calvary. Every single drop to wash away our sins. Your sins, my sins. As I shared with him, and you've probably heard before, he paid a price he didn't know. Because we couldn't afford to pay it ourselves. He willingly went to the cross and died for you and for me. That we might be adopted into the forever family of God and live with him forever and ever. But the death of Christ is only part of the gospel. That's only part of it. If the gospel ended at the cross, there would be no good news. There would be no hope. In verses 14 and 19, or through 19, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. And also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are all men most pitiful. The resurrection is the foundation upon which every single thing rests that you and I believe in. It should not surprise us that from the time of the apostles right up until today, the resurrection of Christ has been under attack. It's been denied. There's been so many theories that have been lifted up about what really happened there at the cross. What really happened to the body of Jesus. And I'm not going to go through all of them, and I'm not going to refute all of them, because every single one of them has never withstood a single moment of investigation. and saw him hanging on the cross. They saw him dead. And the moment he died, all the hope that they had within them, that he was in fact the Messiah, died along with them. Christ died for our sins. He's done all he can do. Now it's up to each and every one of us as to what we will do. Every one of us, I'm going to guess because I don't know most of you. I don't even know most of them at Westport Baptist yet. I'm still threatening to take the church directory and just plaque it all down from here now. See if I can learn people just from their eyes up. You know, Billy Graham said something one time that I found absolutely horrifying. And yet I believe it was true. He said the biggest mission field that exists in the United States today is in the church. In fact, in his estimation, 50% of the church membership is unsaved. Every year when he would preach a crusade in North America, they had a school of evangelism that lasted for a week. And I attended the last time he was in Indianapolis. And one of the things that they told him, and nobody attended. church leaders. And yet in every one of those schools of evangelism, before the week was out, there would be pastors who would give their lives to Christ for the first time. I would just challenge you, as we conclude this Holy Week, as we prepare ourselves for our church services this Sunday, to examine your own heart, to ask the Spirit of God to examine you, to search you, to know you, to help you know yourself, whether or not you are truly in the faith. Romans 10, I'll close with this. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Under righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. But the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Before we sing, I want to say thank you. I'll back up now. I want to say thank you for coming. As Don said earlier, you have exceeded our expectation. And because of that reason, I want to go ahead and plant some seeds that the Monday before Thanksgiving, we will have our community Thanksgiving praise and worship time, and we will have it here. And I would like to pack it out even more, because it'd be a lot better there. You know, no matter what the virus brings, no matter what this world may give us, we can stand firm in Jesus